Dr. Chekiton Singh, actually, he's from Rohtak. He's been, I can say he started his career as with UV and vitreoretina specialist. Then now he is also doing a, interestingly, refractive surgery. I think he has got a numerous degree, and he has also got a FRCS from the Glasgow Royal College of Surgeons. So he's been doing, he has got a lot of publications, and he has presented in a lot of paper presentation in almost international conference. He has got a lot of publication even in the journal. So it's over to you, Chekiton.
Thank you, sir. Sir, please, can you...
Stop sharing. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir, for the kind introduction. I wish to thank the AIOS Scientific Committee, Dr. Partha, Dr. Namrata Sharma, Dr. Krishna Prasad, who has been my mentor actually in teaching me refractive surgery. I learned it from him at Udupi at his center. And I wish to thank Carl Zeiss India Limited for giving me an opportunity to present my views on the mystery of a versatile laser. I have no financial interests. So the unfolding of the mystery started with me going into the details of different companies. In 2016, we wanted to buy a laser. So I went into the details and I was pleasantly surprised that Zeiss was a more than 150-year-old company. It was one of the oldest existing optics manufacturers in the world. It was a world leader in optics with fundus cameras, microscopes, lenses, lasers, and even semiconductors. We have an association with Zeiss of more than 25 years in our hospital, and it has stood for impeccable quality, value, and things which are built to last. So my wish list for picking a refractive platform was cutting-edge technology, which should be clinically relevant, should have the best optics in business, should be easy to use, should have less recurring costs, should be sturdy, and should have excellent service backup. The cutting edge technology, what I wanted to do was I wanted to compare it, unraveling the mysteries of the competitors. So you can see that the Zeiss Mel-90 is here and all the latest machines which are there in the market are there. So this is the only laser which was dual frequency. It was one of the fastest laser around, although the Schwind-Ameris had double the frequency, but the speed of correction was the same. It had a very good eye tracker. It had a flying spot configuration and a Gaussian beam profile, which is required. It had the advantage of offering topo-guided treatment and press biopic correction, and also offered a femtosecond link. The features which I really admired, for me, the unique selling point was FlexSequence, which was 250 and 500 hertz switch, which was possible, a good eye tracker, an advanced ablation algorithm, ultra-fast speed, and topo-guided LASIK and press bio additions, which were possible. There is absolutely hassle-free gas exchange, no nitrogen generator, as the beam is in a vacuum path. And in the last 4 years that I've used this machine, there have been absolutely virtually no breakdowns. My preferred range of corrections have been myopia 8 to 9 diopters, hyperopia up to 5 diopters, and astigmatism up to 4 to 5 diopters. So unraveling the mystery of dual frequency, why do we need dual frequencies? We need the faster frequency or the 500 hertz for standard LASIK, because once you make the flap, you know, the stroma is exposed and there are different ways it can get dry or get overhydrated and can result in different results. So you need a faster laser for standard LASIK, but for 250 hertz, you need a gentle treatment for the surface. And it is postulated that the 250 hertz avoids overheating of the cornea and thus reduces corneal haze and subsequent regressions after PRK. The advanced ablation algorithm which this machine offered was a one profile which fits all. It combines the tissue saving properties of the TSA, which was there in the MEL-AT, and aspherical optimization algorithm, which has been added to it subsequently. It maintains asphericity with still very little tissue consumption. Centration, eye tracking, and angle kappa really gains significance in hyperopic corrections, where the angle kappa is slightly on the nasal side. Angle kappa is the angle between pupillary axis and the visual axis. So this machine gives you an opportunity to merge the fixation light, which is the eye tracker centration, versus the fixation light green one, where the patient is fixating. So you can always, always recenter it so that both are at the same point, and that leads to better corrections and overall better results. The importance of cyclotorsion, especially in higher cylindrical corrections, more than 1.5 diopters cannot be overemphasized. Dr. Dan Reinstein's data shows that. And you can see that for higher corrections, 2 to 3 diopters or beyond, even a 5-degree axis rotation error could lead to an undercorrection of 0.5 to 1 diopter of astigmatism, leading to an unhappy patient. There are two ways to compensate for it. One is the automatic one, which is the oculine feature, which is there with the Vasca analyzer in the Zeiss machine. However, I do it manually with a bubble marker, like you do in the toric IOLs. And then there is a feature called the zero line, which you press. When you press that and the patient is aligned, red laser light is projected onto the cornea and the marks have to be aligned with that light. And I have been surprised that in higher corrections, there have been 10 to 15 degree errors, which were there. So correcting that leads to an absolutely stellar performance of the laser and very good post-operative results. And it is already published that manual nimble markings and iris registration software are equally effective and safe. Coming to the press beyond feature, which this laser offers, I think it is one of the most comprehensive presbyopia correcting platforms, works on the principle of laser blended vision that increases depth of focus by controlled induction of spherical aberrations and by micro monovision. As you can see, apart from the young patient, only the press beyond patient has a blend zone in between. And all other ways of correcting presbyopia have gaps in them and thus dissatisfied patients. The proof of the pudding lies in eating it. So our experience and results with the versatile MEN 90 are here. We did a part of the refractive surgery record analysis, and out of 703 eyes, male and female distribution was pretty equal. The mean age was 22 years, 97% satisfaction in patients, which is really great for a refractive platform. We did around 38% PRKs and around 62% SBK LASIK. The correction ranged from minus 0.5 diopter to minus 11 diopter in myopia and plus 0.5 diopter to 5 diopter hyperopic correction. Cylinders were corrected up to 5 diopter cylinder, even in the plus range up to 4 diopters. And our experience showed that 95% of the total patients achieved uncorrected visual acuity of 6x6. 99% of the LASIK patients achieved UCVA of 6x6. 90% of the PRK patients achieved visual acuity of 6x6. And if you add the ones with 6x6 partial vision, that is 8%, it goes to 98% for PRK. So slowly we have, you know, started in confusing cases or thinner corneas. We have started doing more and more number of PRKs, which I was really happy to learn that LV Prasad has also data on that, and they have published on it with excellent results. Our experience also with the Moria SBK 1U plus microkeratome has been phenomenal. From day one, I have adapted to SBK LASIK, creating 100 micron planar flaps with the 90 micron head. Have made flaps in Ks ranging from 40 to 47 diopters. Very low complication rates. It has a disposable head with blade, eliminates risk of cost and re-sterilization. Very good flap edges, absolutely no DLKs and no epithelial ingrowths in my cases. Visually insignificant microstriae have definitely been observed, especially in the left eye, probably because I'm right-handed. So when we are ironing the flap, sometimes because of thin flap sets there, but none of them have really caught vision problems. Flap-related complications have been very fairly low, less than 1%, 2 incomplete flaps and 2 free caps in 4 years, all in the first year. My take-home message would be to invest wisely, especially in the post-COVID scenario. Zeiss has the most comprehensive and upgradable refractive platform as of today. The most number of experience with SMILE is there with Zeiss, and it has already shifted the world. And you will have to price your refractive procedures in these times attractively to achieve viability, excellent results, and commitment to quality alone triumphs. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Chikitan. I think to discuss this particular about the versatile laser, I request Dr. Sujata Mohan and Dr. Pooja Kamar. Dr. Sujata?
You have to unmute. Dr. Sujata, please unmute yourself.
Okay, it's a very interesting laser. I mean, I really had a look at it before. I went in for my FS 200 with the Excimer 500, EX500. It has a lot of benefits, as has been very well explained. And I think it all depends on what you are comfortable with and what type of laser you've been using from the beginning. And I mean, MEL 90, I think, is really one of the very best lasers in the market, because it very closely follows, very similar to what we are using the Allegretto. And I think I'm sure the results will be fantastic with that, though I don't have any personal experience with MEL 90. From what he says, I'm sure he's got fantastic experience. And as far as the microkeratoma is concerned, I think the later versions of the microkeratomes are almost all on par. We don't see any of those problems we used to see in the previous era. And I've been using Amadeus for quite some time and hardly had any flat-related complications. It all depends upon how you're using the parameters. And now, I think most of us have converted to almost doing 100% femto, so we don't see them anymore. And I'm sure you know the combination of this microkeratome with the ML90 is definitely an excellent one.
Comments from Pooja?
A very nice talk, Dr. Singh. But I just want to know from you and the other panelists, like Dr. Kudlu sir and all, about the topo-guided treatments in MEL90. How well the topo-guided treatments are, because you know nowadays everyone talks, even in for your regular corneas, for your LASIK treatments, they say you should do a topo-guided treatment rather than just aberration-free or wavefront optimized. So that is one thing I would like to know from you and the other esteemed panelists.
Ma'am, I do not have experience with the topo-guided. I'm still going to upgrade because it's 3-4 years now I've been. But Dr. Krishna Prasad, I think, sir, would be.
Yeah, right. Topo-guided treatment we have been doing only in a complicated case like post-residual refractory error or some suspicious case. But apart from that, we have been doing, I don't have MEL90 laser. I do have got MEL80 laser, that is an older version. Still, we can do topo-guided treatment with that. Only in the complicated case, I've been trying to do the topo-guided. I think, Sonu, what is your opinion about topo-guided?
I think, yes, topo-guided, we reserve only for basically retreatments or badly scarred corneas, not for all. And there is a lot of noise. I just wanted to raise one question here. A lot of noise about contour vision. So vis-a-vis smile and a lot of, you know, this has been talk everywhere. So I think from the experienced senior surgeons, I would just request to pitch in and let us, the public in general should realize, our audience should realize, what is the major difference between Contura and Smile? Are we comparing the two technologies on the same platform, or it is just, you know, kind of a, you know, promotional policy of one over the other? Dr. Mahipal is here. I think Dr. Amrita, ma'am.
Dr. Can I comment on that?
Yeah, ma'am. Please.
I'm sure people are using Allegretto. Almost all of us are doing the Contura. Dr. Ramurthy and Dr. Rohit Shetty, and definitely it has its value, and particularly in astigmatism over 0.75 and in virgin corneas, definitely it has an edge. And probably, I mean, I don't do smiles, so there's no comparison. So people like Ramurthy and Rohit will be the better judges. And from my point of view, was wavefront optimized versus Contura, there is a definite mileage.
Thank you so much.